over one sinner who repents. So you see, there is joy in heaven when one sinner comes to the knowledge of God. Because it is the will of God that everyone should repent. And what is repentance? Repentance is acknowledging that you are a sinner. Acknowledging and agreeing with God that you are a sinner. Then turning away from sin, confessing your sins to God, and believing and receiving Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior. That is what repentance is. So, when one person repents, when they acknowledge that they are sinners, and they confess their sins, and they believe and receive Jesus as the Lord of their life and personal Savior, the Word of God tells us that the angels of God rejoice over that one person who has repented. So, that pleases God. It pleases the angels of God in heaven, because it is the will of God for each and every person who ever existed on earth. Every person that was born into this world, they deserve and they need salvation. And that salvation is only found in Christ Jesus. So that pleases God when a sinner comes to repentance. Your life is precious to God. Your knowledge of Christ makes your life to be precious and valuable to God. God paid the highest price to redeem you from the bondage of sin. The righteous blood of Christ shed on the cross was the highest price God could give for you. The Word of God tells us in Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement for your soul." So, this is the will of God, that people should come to the knowledge of Christ, that you may believe and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior. That is the will of God for you. And as we have seen, that pleases God, that when you come to that knowledge of truth, and your life will bring glory to God the moment you come to that knowledge of truth and believe and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior. So, that is the number one benefit, that the moment you believe and receive Jesus, your life will bring glory to God. And as we have seen, that angels in heaven rejoice because of that one soul that comes to repentance. The number two benefit is that you will receive, or rather you will perceive, the presence of God in your life. The moment you believe and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, you will begin to perceive the presence of God in your life. Why? Because the moment you believe and receive Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes into you. Because your sins have been forgiven. And that applies the moment you believe and receive Jesus. When you believe and receive Jesus, is receiving the gift, is receiving the sacrifice that God has given for your sins. Therefore, you are reconciled back to God because you have believed and received Jesus. And therefore, you will perceive the presence of God in your life. Because it is sin that separates us from God. Every time, even for a born-again Christian, the moment you engage in sin, sin has a way of veiling your ability to perceive the presence of God in your life. It is until you confess that sin. And that is why 1 John chapter 1, verse 8 to 10 is made for born-again Christians. That if we say that we are without sin, we make God to be a liar. But if we confess our sins, the Word of God tells us He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And therefore, you will be able to perceive the presence of God in your life the moment you believe and receive Jesus, and the moment you start living your life in accordance to God's Word. Then you will perceive the presence of God in your life. So that is a benefit. When you perceive the presence of God in your life, it is a benefit to you Because your life will be secure. When you believe and receive Christ as Lord of your life and personal Savior, you become a child of God. The Word of God tells us in John chapter 1, verse 12 to 13, yet to all who did receive Him, to those who believed Him, to those who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or of husband's will, but born of God. The moment you believe and receive Jesus, you become a child of God. How does it feel when you are a child of God? It feels great. Because there is none that is beyond God. So when your Father is God, then you should walk in the fullness of God in your life. So therefore, when you believe and receive Jesus, you will have the benefit of perceiving the presence of God in your life. And as I said in previous messages, that if you are a child of God, if you are born again, and you cannot perceive the presence of God in your life, chances are that you are not living in accordance to the Word of God. Because until you begin to live in accordance to the Word of God, then you will be able to perceive the presence of God in your life. Know that God is not there. Know that the Holy Spirit of God is not in you. He is in you, but you cannot perceive His presence. Because sin fails your ability to perceive the presence of God in your life. And when you cannot perceive the presence of God in your life, then you are vulnerable to attacks by the enemy. God indwells His children. You will perceive His presence in your life because He is in you by His Spirit. The Word of God tells us in John chapter 14, verse 22 to 23. Judas said unto Him, and this Judas is not His child, Lord, how is it that You will manifest Yourself unto us and not unto the world? Jesus answered and said unto Him, if a man love Me, he will keep My words, and My Father will love him, and we will come into him and make our abode with him. That is what Jesus has said. The moment we believe and receive Him, and we begin to live in accordance to His word, He has said that He comes into us by His Holy Spirit, and He makes His home in us. He makes His abode in us. And when Jesus is in you, when God the Father is in you, when the Holy Spirit is in you, then your life is secure. And you need to perceive their presence in you. You need to perceive the presence of the Holy Spirit in you. You need to perceive that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are in you. And when you begin to perceive the presence of the Trinity in you, I tell you, brothers and sisters, you will be able to feel that you are living a life that is elevated to a level that you will be able to see Satan and his works as being under your feet, because that is where Satan is. To those who perceive the presence of God in their lives, to those who know who they are in Christ Jesus, Satan is under their feet. You will not fear any works of the devil. You will not fear any attacks from the enemy, because Satan is under your feet, because the Trinity indwells you. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit indwells you. Because that is what Jesus has said. That Jesus answered and said unto Him, if a man loves Me, he will keep My words, and My Father will love him, and we will come into him and make our abode with him. When Christ is in you, demons cannot stand your presence. You will be going into a place and demons will be uncomfortable because of the presence of God. Because your presence represents the presence of God. You will be walking into a place where demons reign and demons will start fleeing from you. Just like it happened, Jesus will enter into a synagogue, and a synagogue was a setup just like this church setup. People are seated down, but one among them is demon possessed. But because of the presence of Jesus, the demon in that person begins speaking because it feels uncomfortable because of the presence of Jesus. It will happen to you the moment you begin to perceive Jesus in your life, the moment you begin to perceive the Trinity in you, because God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are in you by the Holy Spirit. Then you'll be be walking into a place and demons will be uncomfortable with your presence. Why? Because of the Trinity is in you. And you will be able to bind and cast out demons because of Christ in you. You will be able to do mighty things. As Jesus said in John chapter 14 verse 12, that you shall do greater things than these because I have gone to the Father. And what are these greater things that Jesus did? Well, Jesus is telling us in John chapter 14 verse 12 that we shall do greater things than he did. Look at what Jesus did. Jesus raised the dead. Jesus healed the sick. Jesus cast out demons. And then he tells us in John chapter 14 verse 12 that we shall do greater things than that because he has gone to the Father. Indeed, we shall do greater things than that because he has gone to the Father and he is in us by his Holy Spirit. So we are drawing from him. So the moment you begin to live by the word of God, you will begin to perceive the presence of God in your life. And you will be able to do greater things that Jesus promised that you will be able to do. You will be able to lay hands on the sick and the sick will receive their healing. You will be able to raise the dead. You know, people think that it is not possible to raise the dead. Jesus said that you will be able to raise the dead. That is what he taught us. He commissioned us in Matthew chapter 10 verse 8. He says, in Matthew chapter 10 verse 8, heal the sick, cast out, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons, raise the dead, freely you have received, freely give. So he has given us the power. So it is us who are not applying it. Why? Because until we begin living in accordance to his word, then you are going to perceive his presence. And the moment you begin to perceive his presence, you will be able to walk in the fullness of God. You will be able to do the things that Jesus did. You will be able to do even greater things because he has promised that you will do greater things. And because he's in you, so you are drawing from him, you will be able to do greater things. Because he's God, he's not a liar. God says in John chapter 17, verse 17, that his word is truth. And therefore, if we are saying that you will do greater things, certainly you will do greater things because he's in you by his Holy Spirit. You will do greater things than he did because he's in you and you're drawing from him. So therefore, you will perceive the presence of God in your life the moment you believe and receive Jesus. Because it is the will of God for you. Because of God's presence in you, Satan has no free way in your life. Because you perceive his presence in you, you perceive God's presence in you, you can have faith to call on his name when you are in trouble, and he shall save you. You see, the moment you perceive the presence of God in your life, because you are living by his word, when trouble comes, you have faith to call on his name. And the moment you call on his name, then you'll be saved from whatever situation. Because he's the power above all powers and the name above all names. So, the moment you begin to know the will of God for your life, and you get to know that the will of God for your life is to believe and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, and grow in him and begin to serve him, then you will walk in the presence of God. And as you walk in the presence, as you walk in the fullness of God and in the presence of God, you will be able to walk full of the anointing power of the Holy Spirit. So you will also be able to know God. The word of God tells us in Romans chapter 10 verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You cannot call on the name of the Lord when you don't know him. The scripture tells us about seven sons of Sceva. These sons tried to cast out demons in the name of Jesus. Jesus that they did not know. So this is what they say. They came to a demon-possessed person. We know mad people who walk, you know, we see mad people walking about here on the street. So this is what the sons of Sceva tried to do. They tried to cast out demons when they didn't have a personal relationship with Jesus. So they say, in the name of Jesus who Paul preaches, We command you to come out. So, this demon answered, said, and told him, Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. Who are you? And this demon-possessed person, in the power of demons, he was able to beat them up, and they left that place thoroughly beaten and naked. Why? Because they were calling on the name of Jesus. Jesus they did not have a relationship with. Jesus that they did not know. So the moment you know Jesus, the moment you walk in his word, you will be able to walk in the fullness of God. You will be able to perceive the presence of God in your life. And therefore you will be able to cast down demons. And you will be able to call on his name. And any situation that is contrary to his will align to his will, because you have called on his name. That is why he has said, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You cannot call on his name when you don't know him. The word of God tells us in John chapter 10 verse 30. I and my Father are one. So Jesus is saying that God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit are one. So the moment you know Jesus, you have known the Father. You have known the Holy Spirit. That's why Jesus says in John chapter 10 verse 30 that I and my Father are one. Because he is in you, by his Holy Spirit, you will know him. The word of God tells us in John chapter 14, verse 17 to 18. The Spirit of truth, the world cannot accept him, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. When Jesus was ascending to heaven, he told his disciples that he was not going to leave them as orphans, that he was going to send them the Helper, that he was going to send the Holy Spirit. And he said that the Holy Spirit cannot be received by those who are in the world. People who are in the world are people who do not know Jesus. When the Bible is talking about the world cannot know him, Jesus is saying that those who have not believed and received him as the Lord of their lives and personal Savior cannot receive the Holy Spirit, cannot know him. But then he has said, those who have believed and received him as the Lord of their lives and personal Savior, they will receive the Holy Spirit, and he will be in us forever. And therefore, when the Holy Spirit is in us, we are able to perceive the presence of God, because we are in the will of God. There is no way the Holy Spirit will come to unbeliever, because they are not living in the will of God. But you who knows the will of God, who knows that the will of God is to believe and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, and you have believed and received him as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, and you have made a deliberate effort to grow in him, and you are living by his word, then you are living in the will of God. Because until you begin to grow in Jesus, you will not be able to perceive the gift that God has put in you. And God desires that you begin to use the gift that he has put in you to serve him. And therefore, you need to grow. If you have already believed and received Jesus, you need to grow in him. The word of God tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18 that we beholding the glory of God, we are being changed into his image from glory to glory. That's what the word of God tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. That beholding on the glory of Jesus, we are being changed into his image from glory to glory. Because that is the will of God. That is the will of God for you and I, that we may grow in Christ. So that as we continue growing in him, we'll be able to perceive our area of gifting and be able to serve him in the gifts that he has put in us. It is the same thing the word of God tells us in Romans chapter 8 verse 29. That for those he foreknew, he also predestined them to be conformed to the image of his Son, so that his Son may be the firstborn among many brethren. So it is the will of God that you may continue growing in Christ, so that you may begin serving God. Because the will of God is that you go beyond believing and receiving Jesus to also now growing in Him. So that as you continue growing in Jesus, you will be able to do the things that Jesus did. You will be able to witness for Him. You will be able to do the things that Jesus did in the process of advancing the kingdom of God. That you will be able to witness for Christ. And you will be able to overcome all the obstacles that Satan will put in the way of your effort to advance the gospel. Because every born again Christian has been commissioned to take the gospel to the world. Every born again Christian has been commissioned to witness for Christ. And you've been empowered to be able to witness for Christ. You've been empowered to be able to tell others about Jesus. And you've been empowered such that if you encounter any obstacles, and always obstacles come as the works of the devil. The devil is the one who will try to place obstacles in the way of advancement of the gospel. And God has given you the power. Jesus has empowered you to be able to overcome those obstacles and be able to advance the gospel and be able to tell someone about Jesus and be able to lead them to faith in Him. So, you need to continue growing in Jesus. You need to continue growing in Him. So, the number three benefit of believing and receiving Jesus as the Lord of your life and Savior, which is God's will for you, is that knowing Christ is to be spiritually minded. When you know the Lord, when you know Jesus, when you have believed and received Him as the Lord of your life and Savior, you are spiritually minded. Having Christ as the Lord of your life and Savior pleases God. The Word of God tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 to 11. Therefore, God exalted Him to the highest place and gave Him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So, it pleases God the moment someone comes to the knowledge of Christ. It is the will of God that everyone gets to know Jesus, that everyone gets to believe and receive Him. That is what the Word of God has told us there in Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 to 11. That God exalted Jesus to the highest place and gave Him the name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is God, to the glory of God the Father. So it brings glory to God the moment we acknowledge the Lordship of Jesus. And there is no way one can say that they acknowledge Jesus when they have not believed and received Him. Because therefore what then they have is the head knowledge. The head knowledge cannot save a person. It is going and acting in line with the knowledge that you have. Taking action and receiving Him is what saves you. Knowing and receiving Christ as your Lord and personal Savior shows that you know life is both spiritual and physical. When you believe and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, which is the will of God for you, it shows that you know that life is both physical and spiritual. Life is physical because we are living here on earth. But this physical life is temporal. But life is also spiritual because how you live your life here on earth determines how you are going to spend your eternity after you have exited from this body. After your body has died, how you live will determine how or where your soul will go, where your spirit will go. If you lived your life regardless of God, without thinking about this Jesus, without believing and receiving Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, then if you die in that state, the Word of God is clear. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, the Word of God tells us that there is no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood. That's what the word of God tells us in Hebrews chapter 9 verse 22. And in Hebrews chapter 9 verse 27, the word of God tells us that it is given for one to die once, after that judgment. So therefore, it is the will of God that everyone comes to the knowledge of truth and believes and receives Jesus as the Lord of their lives and personal Savior. For that is the will of God for them. The word of God tells us in Matthew chapter 6 verse 31 to 33. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Seeking the kingdom of God and his righteousness is believing and receiving Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior. That is where it all begins. Then, growing in him by applying his word in your life. Then, as you continue growing in Jesus, you are going to discover the gift that God has put in you. Then God requires that you begin to use that gift to serve him. And God will use you to fulfill the purpose for which he created you. For that purpose is that you may get to bring glory to his name. As the word of God in our message today tells us, in Isaiah 43 verse 7, that God created us and everything he created for his own glory. So your life will bring glory to God because you have believed and received Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, which is God's will for you. Knowing and receiving Christ as your Lord and personal Savior shows that you know life is both spiritual and physical. Physical is temporal and is passing away, but spiritual is eternal. God is pleased when you seek him first and not the temporal things of this world. Knowing Christ is knowing the only way to God. As the word of God tells us in John chapter 14 verse 5 to 6, that knowing Jesus is knowing the way to God. Thomas said to him in John chapter 14 verse 5 to 6, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So Jesus is the truth, the way, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through him. So the moment you know Jesus, the moment you have believed and received him as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, you have known the way to God. And you have known the will of God for your life. God loves his creation. He created us for his glory. That was his will for us, that we may be of glory to him. When our foreparents Adam and Eve disobeyed God in Genesis chapter 3 verse 4 to 6, that glory was lost. God has made intervention by giving out his son, Christ Jesus, to take the form of man and die for us on the cross. His blood of atonement paid the price for our sins. He redeemed us from the bondage and guilt of sin and reconciled us back to God. The glory that was lost has now been restored by God himself through Christ Jesus. Every time a person believes and receives Christ as Lord of their life and personal Savior, they are restored back to God's glory, back to God's will. When a person who has believed and received Christ died, they have eternal life, and their soul go to heaven. However, it is not so for those that have not received Jesus. Their souls go to hell. So knowing Christ, growing in him, and serving him is the will of God for you. I repeat, what is the will of God for you? What is the will of God for your life? The will of God for your life is believing and receiving Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior. Then growing in Christ, so that now you begin to serve him. And How do you serve Him? You serve Jesus in your area of gifting. As you continue growing in Him, you will discover your area of gifting. Then you'll begin to serve Him through that gift. The Word of God tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 11. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 11. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So that is what brings glory to God. When every knee bows at the Lordship of Jesus, when every tongue confesses that Jesus Christ is Lord, that is what brings glory to God. And if you have done that, if you have believed and received Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior, then God is pleased with you. God is happy with you. And you will perceive the presence of God in your life if you live in accordance with His word. Because you don't just come and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and personal Savior. Then you go out there and begin to live as if nothing has happened in your life. God expects you to live worthy of your confession of Christ. Let people not say that those are Christians. See what they are doing. Because then that brings the name of the Lord to disrepute. That is like crucifying Jesus a second time. So God desires that we grow in the image of Jesus. And the way to grow in the image of Jesus is by taking in His word, meditating on His word, applying His word in every area of our lives. Then we are going to grow in Him because we are walking in obedience to His word. The word of God tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. So as we look at Jesus, as we emulate Jesus, He is changing us into His image from glory to glory. So every time you are doing something, be asking yourself, what would Jesus do in my situation? What would He do in a situation like this? Even ask Him, Jesus, what do you want me to do? Guide me by your Holy Spirit to do that which you will do if you are